Thank you. Yes, please. Thank you very much, Prajwal. You're so efficient that you've practically given my lecture. And that young baby you are referring to is sitting here in the audience. Good afternoon and happy equinox. May I at the outset thank the faculty and the director of this institute for inviting me to deliver this year's Venubhav Memorial Lecture. May I also take this opportunity to thank everyone at this institute, past and present, for the courtesy you have extended me over the last 40 years or more. I wish to talk to you today about recycled pulsars. This subject, like a good wine from Bordeaux, has aged and matured excellently. Although the original ideas were advanced nearly 40 years ago, it is witnessing a great renaissance today. But I shall be serving you this wine in the original bottle. I must warn you that this will be a very personal account of the history of recycled pulsars, and given the special nature of this occasion, I hope you will pardon me for it. I shall begin by quoting the great bard. Masters, I am to discourse wonders, but ask me not what. For if I tell you, I am no true Athenian. I will tell you everything right as it fell out. Now, as I said, although the concept of recycled pulsars is nearly 40 years old, they are the subject of intense study today for two reasons. One is the coming of age of gamma ray astronomy. And second, the imminent prospect in a year or so of detecting gravitational waves from merging neutron star systems as well as from millisecond pulsars. Now, as a neutron star is spun up by accretion, little hillocks can form, giving it a quadrupole moment, and therefore it limits gravitational radiation. Now, and when a neutron star is spun up to a millisecond, the chances of detecting the gravitational radiation is significantly enhanced because the luminosity is proportional to the sixth power of the period of rotation. One of the great discoveries made by Chandrasekhar and then generalized by his student John Friedman is that a rapidly spinning body is unstable in general relativity to non-axisymmetric perturbations, which are themselves driven by gravitational radiation. But this instability can be suppressed by the viscosity of the superfluid core of the neutron star. And because of all these reasons, superfluid states inside a neutron star are once again a subject of great interest. First, a crash course on pulsars. This plot of the magnetic field in the y-axis and the logarithm of the rotation period on the x-axis is the analog of the famous Hertzsprung-Russell diagram in stellar physics. Neutron stars are born in the top left-hand corner of this diagram, spinning very rapidly with a very high magnetic field. Because the radiation they emit carries away energy and angular momentum, they slow down. And because the rate of slowing down is proportional to the square of the strength of the magnetic field, neutron stars with very large magnetic fields will race to the right, whereas neutron stars with slightly more modest fields will crawl towards the right. The end result is a traffic jam or a piling up of pulsars, and an island of pulsars forms over there. And today, there are roughly 2,500 pulsars in that island. Neutron stars function as pulsars for a few million years, and they suddenly switch off. They switch off when the voltage they generate by virtue of their strong magnetic field and rapid rotation drops below a critical value that is needed for copious electron-positron pair production. And that theoretically calculated voltage line is shown as a red line in this diagram, which is now come to be called as the death line. You will notice that there are no pulsars to the right of this death line, and this region represents the graveyard of pulsars that Prajwal referred to. And our story today begins in this graveyard. It all began in 1974 with the discovery of the first binary pulsar by Joe Taylor and his student Hulse. In addition to being the very first binary pulsar, it was also a very odd pulsar, as you will see. As you all know, Taylor and Hulse were awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics for the discovery of this most remarkable system. Now here is a system of a double neutron star system, but we only see one neutron star because that is the only one that is beamed towards us. This second neutron star, unseen by us, is beaming towards some other part of the galaxy. So when I refer to the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, I am referring to the neutron star in this binary that we do see. Now this pulsar is spinning. This pulsar is located way outside this island of pulsars that I referred to. The binary pulsar that I'm referring to is sitting over there. Its very short rotation period of 59 milliseconds suggested that it's a very young pulsar. Please remember the Crab pulsar, which is only 1,000 years old, is spinning at the rate of 33 milliseconds. On the other hand, its anomalously low magnetic field of 10 to the power 10 Gauss instead of 10 to the power 13 Gauss suggested that it might be a very old pulsar. Or this may just be a coincidence. Maybe it is just an odd pulsar born with a low magnetic field. If that is so, then there is a second coincidence. How come this is the only pulsar which is in a binary system? And that would have made Miss Marple very unhappy. Any evidence, said Miss Marple to herself, is always worth noticing. You can throw it away later if it is only a coincidence. In 1978, I was still working in problems in condensed matter physics, and I came across this quote in a paper by Sidney Vandenberg, if I'm not mistaken, about this binary pulsar, which had just been discovered. And that's how I got interested in astronomy and in this problem in particular. I must tell you about that idea, which involves the reincarnation of pulsars. So my idea was simply the following, that this very odd Hulse-Taylor pulsar is born in a binary system. It lived a normal life and died a natural death and was given a nice burial in this graveyard. Long time after that, it was resurrected from the graveyard and given a second lease of life by being spun up to a short period to the left of this death line. So that's the concept of reincarnation of pulsars, and this concept is now come to be known as recycling of pulsars, and this phrase recycle pulsars was first coined at the Raman Institute nearly 40 years ago. Now, to make a rapidly rotating pulsar with a very weak magnetic field, two things must happen. Its magnetic field must decay from 10 to the power 13 Gauss. And secondly, it has to be spun up to a very short period. Let us discuss the second aspect first and then return to the magnetic field later on. How can you spin up a neutron star in a binary system? What is shown here is the canonical evolution of a massive binary due to Professor van der Hassel and his team in Amsterdam. What is shown here is a case of two stars, one 25 solar mass and the other 10 solar mass. Not surprisingly, the more massive star evolves faster, transfers much of its mass to the companion, explodes as a supernova, leaving behind a neutron star. And the first neutron star is born in the binary system. The companion star continues to evolve, transfer mass back onto the neutron star, and it is during this phase angular momentum is transferred to the neutron star and it is spun up. Finally, the second star evolves, becomes a supernova, producing the second neutron star. And in most cases, the binary will be disrupted by the second supernova explosion. In very rare circumstances, the binary will remain bound and you will have a double neutron star system, such as the Hall-Saylor binary pulsar system. So this is the standard scenario. So my idea was that this Hall-Saylor binary pulsar was the first born neutron star in a binary system, which had been spun up due to accretion of mass and angular momentum from the giant companion. Now, the idea that the Hall-Saylor pulsar may have been spun up had been suggested by Larry Smarr and Roger Blanford soon after the discovery of the pulsar, but the following question was not addressed by them or anyone else who were writing papers in the subject. And the question was simply the following: what will be the period of rotation of the neutron star after the spin-up phase is over? Now I have to explain how you answer that question. The first thing to appreciate is that a strongly magnetized neutron star accreting from matter from a companion will adjust its period of rotation to an equilibrium value, which I shall call the equilibrium period. And that may be seen rather simply as follows. Because the incoming matter from the companion has a large amount of orbital angular momentum, it will form an accretion disk. Now, the first thing to appreciate is that this accretion disk will not extend and touch the surface of the neutron star itself. That is because the neutron star has a very strong magnetic field, and the magnetic pressure B squared over 8 pi will prevent the incoming matter from falling in till you reach a radius where B squared over 8 pi is precisely equal to the ramp pressure rho V squared of incoming matter. And that radius is known in the literature as Alfvén radius. Now, in principle, this neutron star at the center of the accretion disk could be spinning at any period, compared to the Keplerian period at the inner edge of the accretion disk. But if you think about it a little bit, you can come to the conclusion that this neutron star will be very unhappy. What it will do is to adjust its period of rotation such that the period of rotation of the neutron star becomes precisely equal to the Keplerian period at the inner edge of the accretion disk. This is the equilibrium period to which I referred to before. So my first task was to derive an expression for this equilibrium period, which is not a very difficult thing to do. Apart from the radius and mass of the star, this equilibrium period depends on two things. It depends directly on the strength of the magnetic field, which is trying to keep matter away, and it depends inversely on the rate of accretion of matter onto the neutron star. So, around June or so in 1978, I came to the conclusion that the Hall-Saylor binary pulsar was spun up along the lines that I said, and that its present period of rotation must be very close to the equilibrium period. Could I calculate this equilibrium period? Surely not, because the equilibrium period depends on two things. It depends on the strength of the magnetic field of the neutron star, and it depends upon the inversely on the accretion rate. And we weren't present when this accretion took place. So, following thing needs to be appreciated. If I increase the accretion rate, shorter will be the equilibrium period, as shown in this diagram. Secondly, for a given value of the accretion rate, smaller the magnetic field, shorter will be the equilibrium period. So now the following question arises. For a neutron star of a given magnetic field, can I spin it up to arbitrarily short period by going on increasing the accretion rate? And I came to the conclusion, no, you cannot do that. And the reason is the following. So let's go back in time to 1923, Eddington's book on the internal constitution of the stars, and try to recall what Eddington taught us. What is shown here is a unit mass of stellar material at a distance small r from the center of the star in radiative equilibrium, a concept that Eddington introduced. If you forget gas pressure for the moment, what this means is the radiative force acting on that unit volume is precisely balanced by the gravitational force acting due to the mass interior to it. Now let's assume that there are n electrons and n protons in this unit volume. The radiative force acting on this unit volume is given by a very simple expression, which is the luminosity generated at the center divided by 4 pi r squared times the velocity of light multiplied by the total scattering cross section of this unit volume, which is simply the number of electrons, number density of electrons multiplied by the Thomson scattering cross section. Please remember, because the protons are 2000 times heavier, they can be ignored in the context of radiative force. This Thomson scattering cross section is of course determined by the classical radius of the electron. Now this radiative force acting on this unit volume must be balanced by the gravitational force due to the matter interior to it, which is G, capital M, which is the mass interior to the radius, mass of that unit volume, which is the number times the mass of the proton, divided by R squared. So for radiative equilibrium, the gravitational force, which is the left-hand side, must be balanced by the radiative force, which is the right-hand side. And this expression can be solved. And what we get is one of the most beautiful formulas in all of physics. This is known as the Eddington luminosity limit. So what this means is, the luminosity of a star can never exceed this value. And this limiting luminosity is independent of the radius of the star and the temperature of the star. It is determined uniquely by the mass of the star, apart from fundamental constants which are inside that parenthesis. The numerical value of this limiting luminosity is 10 to the power 38 erg per second for a star of the mass of the sun. A beautiful result. Now, if I drop an electron or a proton to fall onto the surface of the neutron star, the gravitational potential energy released is enormous. In fact, the gravitational potential energy released is roughly 10% of the rest mass energy of the falling body. Therefore, when matter rains on the surface of a neutron star, there will be a tremendous luminosity generated, mostly in the X-ray region of the electromagnetic spectrum. That luminosity is roughly 10% of m dot c squared, where m dot is the number of grams per second falling onto the surface of the neutron star. So this is, I scanned this view graph of a talk that I gave in Stockholm in October 1978. So now, here it is simplified. What is shown here is that you cannot go on increasing the rate of accretion onto the neutron star. There is a limiting value m dot Eddington because there is a limiting value to the luminosity you can generate. If you generate more luminosity, then radiation pressure will prevent matter from falling in. So that's all that I had to do. And so now you can go and answer the question that we set to answer initially. The equilibrium period depended on two quantities, the strength of the magnetic field and the rate of accretion. Now we can ask the following question. Since the Eddington luminosity limit defines an upper limit to the accretion rate m dot, there will be a limiting value to the equilibrium period. You cannot spin up a neutron star faster than that. And that limiting period is given by a very simple expression, 1.9 milliseconds. Multiplied by the magnetic field to the power 6 over 7, the magnetic field measured in units of 10 to the power 9 Gauss. You can write this formula in any unit that you wish. Earlier we had asked the following question, can I spin up a neutron star to shorter and shorter period by going on increasing the accretion rate? Now the answer is, no you cannot. This dashed line is the equilibrium period line corresponding to a certain accretion rate. As I go on increasing the accretion rate, you will hit a brick wall. That brick wall is the limiting value of the accretion rate corresponding to the Eddington luminosity limit. So the idea was simply that, yes, one can predict what should be the period of the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar at the end of its accretion period. And that should be very close to this equilibrium period line, which has now been drawn for the limiting value of the accretion rate, which is m dot eddings. In other words, the actual location of this Hulse-Taylor pulsar should be very close to this point in this line, if all this conjecture is true. And it was. So the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar is indeed very close to this critical equilibrium period line. I must stress here, there are absolutely no adjustable parameters in this. Apart from fundamental constants, the only thing that comes in is the mass of the neutron star. So the proximity of this pulsar to this critical equilibrium period line confirmed, at least to me, that this is a recycled pulsar. This was around June 1978. In July 1978, Professor Ed van den Heuvel from Amsterdam, the world's authority on binary evolution, was visiting the Raman Institute for a few days, and I told him about this, and he got terribly excited about it. He went to Radhakrishnan and said, "This is very interesting." And then he left. And then I got a telex from him. Those days we didn't have emails or faxes. And the telex simply said that, "Where is the paper?" Now, I didn't know how to write a paper in astronomy. I was still working in solid state physics. You know, to write a paper, you must know something about the subject. You've got to have some gravy to pour on the idea. So I sent a telex back to Professor van den Heuvel saying that, "Look, will you do me the honor of being a co-author with me and supply the rest of the story?" He readily agreed and he invited me to Amsterdam. And so I went in October 1978 to Amsterdam. Along the way, I caught up with Professor Vidyanand Nanjundaya in Florence and we had a great time there. And then from there, I went to Amsterdam and we wrote up the paper. On this particular occasion, I was record that it was a very important occasion for me. This was the very first paper I was writing in astronomy, and to have the opportunity of having one of the world's leading astrophysicists as a co-author was certainly a very thrilling prospect for me. Now, in that paper, and then of course I left it to him to publish it, and there was a two-year delay in his submitting it to a journal and so on. That doesn't concern us because our story doesn't stop. We had made the following predictions in the paper, that the Hulse-Taylor pulsar is a recycled pulsar from a massive binary. It is the first born neutron star whose field has decayed and which has been spun up. Now, I must stress that this was the very first identification of any pulsar as a recycled pulsar. The very idea of a recycled pulsar didn't exist in the literature. And also, we made a very clear prediction about the second neutron star, which we are not seeing in this particular system. So one picture is worth 10,000 words, as the Chinese saying so, but first let's say it in words. So our prediction was that the second born neutron star, if you were to see it someday, will be just an ordinary pulsar. It will have the canonical high magnetic field of 10 to the power 12.5 Gauss, and its period of rotation will be a few seconds. So here it is in picture. The first born neutron star is recycled. It will have a low magnetic field and a short period of rotation. The second born neutron star is unprocessed because the binary story ends the moment it is born. It will have a canonical high magnetic field and its period of rotation will be a few seconds. In other words, it will be indistinguishable from the large number of pulsars in the population of pulsars. Now, even as Professor van den Heuvel was dealing with this paper, a few months later, Radhakrishnan and I presented a paper in Bandung, and the paper was entitled, "Are Many Pulsars Processed in Binaries?" That paper has this particular diagram in it, and the title of the paper, once again, is "Are Many Pulsars Processed in Binaries?" This was around May 1979, and the occasion was the first regional meeting of the International Astronomical Union that was held in Bandung. It is in that paper, in this figure, that this equilibrium period line, which is now known as the spin-up line, was drawn for the very first time. And also the connection between the extent of the magnetic field decay and the final period to which you can spin up the neutron star was pointed out for the first time in this paper. Now, there were very few takers for this idea at that time, including Joe Taylor himself. And the main skepticism, stemmed from this following. At that time, several dozen X-ray pulsars were known, and their periods of rotation were hundreds of seconds, 600 seconds, 800 seconds, and so on. And none was seen spinning with a short period of 59 milliseconds or thereabouts. Of course, the answer to this question was perfectly obvious, but nobody wanted to think it through. And this question was asked of me as recently as 2005 by a very famous astronomer in MIT. So 24 years after Pandanathan and I published the paper, in 2004, a double neutron star system was discovered. And in this case, both the neutron stars were pointing towards us. It was a happy circumstance. Pulsar A was a millisecond pulsar with a very low magnetic field. Pulsar B was a slowly spinning neutron star with a strong magnetic field and a short characteristic age of only 50 million years. So the discovery of this double pulsar confirmed the prediction we had made way back in 1980, namely, this is the first born neutron star which has been recycled in the binary, and this is the second born neutron star which has been unprocessed in the binary. So now I will move on to the story of the millisecond pulsar, and once again I'll tell the story as it unfolded. This was discovered by Don Backer and his colleague Sri Kulkarni and others in November 1982. I first heard about it in the first page of Deccan Herald. There was a small box which said star spinning 642 times a second. And then when I went to Raman Institute, by the time the IAU telegram, the discovery IAU telegram had come, the period of the pulsar was 1.5 milliseconds, and the early observations suggested that its magnetic field was 10 to the power 12 Gauss. It was a solitary pulsar, not a binary pulsar. Now, there was a problem. If you have a neutron star spinning as rapidly as 1.5 millisecond period, and if it had a strong magnetic field of 10 to the power 12 Gauss, it must produce one hell of a nebulosity surrounding it, just as a Crab pulsar produces the Crab nebula. Except this nebula should be 10,000 times more luminous than the Crab nebula. And it cannot be hidden anywhere in the galaxy. And then I wanted to know, is there anything surrounding the pulsar? I didn't know how to look at the Palomar plate. So I called Professor C.R. Subramania from the TIFR Center in IISc, and he came to Raman Institute, looked at the Palomar plates and said, no, no, there is absolutely nothing surrounding this pulsar. Professor Prabhu was in Kavalur. I booked a trunk call. It took 3 hours to get the phone call through. And he said that there is nothing as far as he also knew. And so, and then I consulted Dr. Marar in ISRO. He said there is nothing in X-rays. So there was absolutely no nebulosity in radio or optical and X-ray surrounding this pulsar. And that reminded me of the story of Silver Blaze. This famous racehorse is stolen. Sherlock Holmes is called from London. He goes around looking with his magnifying glass. And then he tells Dr. Watson, let's go back. And then Inspector asks Holmes, Mr. Holmes, is there anything else you wish to draw my attention to? Holmes says, the curious incidents of the dog that night. Inspector Gregory, the dog did absolutely nothing that night. Sherlock Holmes, that is the curious incident. So, I came to the conclusion that the magnetic field of this pulsar must be many, many orders of magnitude smaller than what the early observations indicated. If this conjecture is true, then there is a curious coincidence once again. If my conjecture was true, then you are dealing with an ultra-rapidly spinning neutron star with a low magnetic field, and that was reminiscent of the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar. But this pulsar was not in a binary, but it was a solitary pulsar. Nevertheless, I was absolutely convinced that this must be a recycled pulsar. Somebody was leaving the Raman Institute and there was a tea party. And so I took Professor Radhakrishnan to the side and I told him, and he got terribly excited about it. And so that's how we developed this idea further and wrote up this paper. The bold conjecture is that this solitary millisecond pulsar must have been a recycled pulsar. It is spinning very rapidly because it has a very low magnetic field, and the equilibrium period corresponding to low magnetic field is an ultra short period. Why is it solitary? Well, it must have got rid of its companion. It got a divorce. And please remember what I said earlier. The red line is the equilibrium period line corresponding to the limiting value of the accretion rate. The period to which you spin up the neutron star depends on the magnitude to which the magnetic field had decayed. So here is the plot of the magnetic field versus the period of rotation. And this is the equilibrium period line. This is the famous Hulse-Taylor pulsar. The millisecond pulsar that had been discovered was located over there, nowhere near this line. On the other hand, if it was a recycled pulsar, it should be located on or very close to this line. All right? So, we sat down and a couple of days wrote up this paper. The essential content was that the solitary millisecond pulsar must have been recycled. Its magnetic field must be 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss. Where did this number come? You read off that line. And what should its period derivative be, the rate of slowing down? 10 to the power minus 19 seconds per second. For your reference, the period derivative of the Crab pulsar is 10 to the power minus 14 seconds per second. So one was saying this is 5 orders of magnitude smaller. So I was very nervous. But then Professor Radhakrishnan, in his characteristic fashion, said, look, Srini, if you're going to be wrong, you might as well be wrong in a grand fashion. So we sat down and wrote this paper. Professor Jerry Ostreicher from Princeton was visiting, and he refereed this paper, as we learned later. And this paper was published within a week after the discovery of the pulsar. A month or so later, a paper appeared in Nature by Ali Alpar, the famous Mal Ruderman, and a couple of other people with an almost identical explanation. 4 months or 5 months after our paper in Current Science, where a concrete prediction had been made about the magnetic field and the period derivative, Andrew Lyon and his collaborators in Manchester measured this accurately. The period derivative was in fact 10 to the power minus 19 seconds per second, and the magnetic field was 4.7 into 10 to the power 8 Gauss. So here is a comparison. The prediction made 5 months earlier is that P dot should be 10 to the power minus 19 seconds per second. It was 10 to the power minus 19 seconds per second. And the paper made no reference to our paper, which was published 5 months earlier. On the right-hand top corner, there was a handwritten note which said, thanks for your paper, it made interesting reading. And this story was to repeat again and again and again. So this pulsar was in fact over there next to this line. The predicted value of the magnetic field and the measured value of the magnetic field agreed excellently well. Now, Radhakrishnan and I pointed out one other thing, which is rather important for our story. If the millisecond pulsar had in fact been spun up to a period of milliseconds, then it must have created an enormous amount of angular momentum, for which it must have created a huge amount of mass, roughly 1/10 of a solar mass. And please remember, a neutron star cannot accrete matter faster than the Eddington rate. And this Eddington rate is 10 to the power minus 8 solar mass per year, or 10 to the power 17 grams a second, or one Mount Everest every second. A neutron star cannot accrete more than one Mount Everest every second. Therefore, to accrete 1/10 of a solar mass, even at this rate, will take 10 million years. Therefore, the progenitor of this millisecond pulsar could not be a massive binary like the progenitor of the Hulse Taylor pulsar, where the story ends in about a couple of million years, but it must be a low mass X-ray binary, where the companion has a mass less than or outer of one solar mass, so that they can be sustained accretion at the Eddington rate for 10 million years. So the clear prediction was made that the progenitor of this millisecond pulsar must have been a low mass X-ray binary. Of course, nobody gave a damn about this because nobody believed this came from a binary. Because if it came from a binary, it had to be that kind of a binary. Nobody believed in the story anyway. Well, as I said, if the solitary pulsar was recycled, where is its companion? Well, we had simply waved our hands and said, somehow the effect of pulsar radiation must have blown away the companion. Now, the evidence for this actually came 6 years later, and I'll come to that in a few minutes. A couple of years later, a second millisecond pulsar was discovered. This one was in a binary. Its orbital period was 120 days, and the companion was in fact a very low mass white dwarf. And so as far as we were concerned, this discovery clinched the issue that the millisecond pulsar, including the solitary millisecond pulsar, must have been recycled in a binary. But the skeptics were not at all convinced, and they remained skeptics for a very, very, very long time. In March 1986, the third millisecond pulsar was discovered, but its parameters were not known. So three groups of people, including Deepankar Bhattacharya, who is here, and me, Professor Pandenhavel and his collaborators, and Sri Kulkarni and Ramesh Narayan, more or less simultaneously published the paper, pointing out that there must be a very large population of millisecond pulsars in the galaxy, numbering perhaps even 100,000, just based on this third detection. How did the argument go? Extremely simple. The essence of that argument is simply the following. All the three millisecond pulsars were very close to the sun and within 25 parsecs of the plane of the galaxy, inside that magenta cylinder. But the scale height of their progenitor, the low mass X-ray binary, is this yellow cylinder. Now, if millisecond pulsars came from low mass X-ray binary, then the scale height of the millisecond pulsars must also be comparable to the scale height of their parents. Therefore, by scaling these two volumes, we immediately arrived at the conclusion that there must be something between 10,000 or 100,000 millisecond pulsars in the galaxy. So this is a very naive argument. You can make it sophisticated by putting in luminosity functions, etc., etc. But for the purpose of this talk, that should be enough to convince you that that is how we made the prediction, that there must be a very large population of millisecond pulsars in the galaxy. Although two other groups, as I said, independently arrived at this conclusion, Deepankar and I didn't stop there. We went on and we went much further and made a series of very bold predictions. And I should stress that these predictions were made before the parameters of this pulsar were discovered. And one very distinguished astronomer said to me, "Oh, you guys are sticking your neck way out." Okay? Then in June 1986, I went to Nanjing. No, before that, I spoke at the Silver Jubilee meeting of this institute in 1986, which was held in Guru Nanak Bhavan near Cantonment Railway Station. And the title of my talk was The Moral of Millisecond Pulsar. And the asterisk next to the title is to remind me to mention on this particular occasion that this title was suggested to me by Professor Rajaram Nityananda, who is sitting in the back of the room over here. Now, in that talk and in the paper we wrote, Deepankar and I, we made the following points. And listen to this, a very simple argument, but a very compelling argument. The population of the parents, the low mass X-ray binaries, is only about 125 in the whole galaxy. How can the number of offsprings be 10,000 or 100,000? Remember, each binary can give birth only to one pulsar. This is only possible if the lifetime of the progenitor is very short compared to the lifetime of the offspring. In other words, the lifetime of the millisecond pulsar must be 100 times longer than the lifetime of the X-ray phase of the low-mass X-ray binary. Now, the lifetime of a low-mass X-ray binary is a staggering 100 million years. Therefore, millisecond pulsars must live for billions of years, not millions of years. They must be as old as the galaxy itself. So Dipankar and I came to the immediate conclusion that millisecond pulsars must live forever. Otherwise, you cannot explain this ratio of the statistics. So here is the magnetic field period diagram, the spin-up line and the death line. Pulsar starts over here, lives a first life, dies, and it is spun up. And if its magnetic field continues to decay, then it will die again. Therefore, the statistics of millisecond pulsars, namely, you can't have 100,000 of them in the galaxy if they were going to die again soon. Therefore, we came to the conclusion millisecond pulsars must live forever. So, like it says in the good book, Christ is crucified on Good Friday, and when he is resurrected on Easter Sunday, this time he lives forever. The trumpet shall sound and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. There's no further decay. So one picture is worth 10,000 words. So Dipankar and I came to the conclusion that the magnetic field of recycled pulsars must represent some sort of an asymptotic field, a limiting value for the magnetic field. And the prediction is that if that were so, then millisecond pulsars will live forever. Now, the predictions made in this current science paper of 1986, just concentrate on this magenta box, is that we believe that there is a very large population, as yet unseen. We believe that most of them will be, in fact, binaries with low-mass white dwarf companions with circular orbits. We predicted that the overwhelming majority of millisecond pulsars in this population will have magnetic fields of the order of 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss, which represents some sort of an asymptotic field, and that their rotation period will be somewhere between 6 and 10 milliseconds. And then I went to Nanjing to speak at an international meeting on the origin and evolution of neutron stars. The day before the meeting, I was introduced to the great Joe Taylor, who congratulated me for the predictions we had made in the current science paper, because he went on to say that they had verified all these predictions. So Joe Taylor and his group had found that the magnetic field of this pulsar was indeed 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss, that the companion was indeed a very low mass white dwarf of the order of 1.1 solar mass, and the orbit was dead circular. So the next day, Joe Taylor was the first speaker of the conference. He presented his results. Then, of course, I presented our current science paper, which had already been published. And then a few weeks later, when Joe Taylor's paper appeared in Nature, there was no reference to our paper. So to summarize the predictions we have made in this paper, Dipankar and I pointed out that the majority of millisecond pulsars will be inside this oval region, periods between 6 and 10 milliseconds, and their magnetic fields will be around 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss. That was 1986. 30 years later, here is the situation. What is shown here are 2,500 pulsars that are known. And inside the magenta circle, there are nearly 100 binary millisecond pulsars, and their mean magnetic field is in fact around 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss. Now, what about the missing companion of the first solitary millisecond pulsar that we claim must have somehow been blown away? In 1988, a very remarkable system was discovered of an eclipsing millisecond pulsar. A millisecond pulsar with a low-mass white dwarf companion, the magnetic axis of the millisecond pulsar was perpendicular to the rotation axis, or in other words, it was in the plane of the orbit. Which means every millisecond that white dwarf is blasted by the radiation, the relativistic beam of particles and radiation from the pulsar hits the white dwarf every rotation. And what is found observationally by detailed radio observation is that this white dwarf is being ablated away, and simple estimates suggest that in a few million years, this white dwarf will be gone. Therefore, this conjecture is not that wild, provided the geometry is favorable. Now I turn to the second important thing for recycling, namely the evolution of the magnetic fields of neutron stars. Now here are the facts. There is absolutely no observational evidence to suggest that solitary neutron stars, which are relatively young, their fields decay. They do not decay at all. Whereas old pulsars, which are roughly billion years old, most of which are binaries, have very low magnetic fields. Therefore, any viable theory of field evolution must explain the following questions. Namely, why the magnetic field of solitary neutron stars does not decay? Why do low field pulsars always occur in binaries? Now, how is the magnetic field in the core of the neutron star destroyed or expelled to the crust? And finally, why is there a residual field in millisecond pulsars? If they are billions of years old, why hasn't the field vanished to nothing? So as to the origin of the magnetic field, the most plausible scenario that most people believe in, that it is just the fossil field of the progenitor amplified during the collapse due to flux conservation. And this was predicted before neutron stars were observed, detected. Therefore, to destroy the exterior magnetic field, the magnetic field in the core of the neutron star must be destroyed, or the core field must be expelled to the crust where it can decay due to ohmic dissipation. And herein lies the difficulty. The difficulty is quite formidable. Now, if the interior of the neutron star is a normal fluid of neutrons, protons, and electrons, then the exterior poloidal magnetic field must be due to toroidal currents in the interior. And the only way you can destroy the exterior magnetic field is by destroying this current loops. And the only mechanism you have is ohmic dissipation. And a simple estimate tells you that the ohmic dissipation timescale is 1,000 times longer than the age of the universe. So you just can't do it. And this large timescale follows from the extreme degeneracy of the protons. But there are very compelling reasons to believe that the interior of a neutron star is not a classical liquid, it's a superfluid. And this was pointed out by A.B. Migdal and B.L. Ginsberg long before neutron stars were discovered. Migdal argued that the protons will be in the superconducting phase, and Ginsberg and Kirchnitz argued that the neutrons will be in the superfluid state. Now, you'll remember a normal superconductor is a perfect diamagnet. It expels the magnetic field. But here the field is inherited magnetic field. It cannot expel the field. So the idea is, how does a superconductor accommodate a magnetic field? Well, this problem was solved in 1958 by another student of Landau, Abrikosov, for which 50 years later he was awarded the Nobel Prize. So was Ginsberg, he shared the Nobel Prize. And what Abrikosov pointed out was that if magnetic field has to penetrate the superconductor, then it will not do so homogeneously, but it will do so as an array of quantized flux tubes, with each flux tube having a quantum of flux 8C divided by 2E. And what you see here is an actual photograph of such quantized flux tube in what is known as a type 2 superconductor. So the picture then is, the interior magnetic field of the neutron star must be as an array of quantized flux tubes in the proton superconductor. And how many flux tubes do you expect to find in a neutron star? Roughly 10 to the power 31 quantized flux tubes. Can you expel this magnetic flux from inside the superconductor? Well, long time ago, Bardeen and Peterson pointed out that the time scale for spontaneous expulsion of a magnetic field from superconductor is around 10 to the power 23 years. So you just can't do it. So there's a serious problem. Regardless of whether the interior is a classical fluid or a superfluid, you cannot destroy the field or spontaneously eject the field. So in 1989, I came up with a completely crazy idea, and the essence of that idea is rather simply described. Please remember that there are two fluids inside the core of the neutron star, the protons, which are superconducting. They are threaded by an array of quantized flux tubes parallel to the magnetic axis. And on the left is shown a photograph of such quantized flux lattice in a type 2 superconductor. At the bottom, you have the neutrons in the core of the neutron star. They are superfluid. It's a superfluid. And because this bucket is rotating, that neutron superfluid is threaded by an array of quantized vortices, with each vortex having a quantum of circulation, which is Planck's constant divided by the mass of the particle. This was first discovered by Ansager and then Feynman. And what is shown on the left is such an array of quantized vortices in a rotating droplet of superfluid. This is all predicted long, long time ago. So, there are two kinds of spaghettis in the core of the neutron star. There are the Feynman vortices in the neutron superfluid, the green ones parallel to the rotation axis, and then there are the quantized flux tubes parallel to the magnetic axis in the proton superconductor. So my crazy idea was that these two types of vortices will strongly pin to one another. And there are many physical reasons for why this pinning is likely, or more than likely, but on this occasion I will not digress into that. Except to say that this pinning can be extremely strong with the pinning energy of the order of a MeV, not milli electron volt, but million electron volts. The rest is simple. Please remember that if you have a bucket of superfluid helium and this bucket is rotating with an angular velocity omega, the number of vortices is uniquely determined by quantum mechanics. The number of vortices is uniquely specified, the moment is specified, the angular velocity of rotation. Therefore, if the beaker slows down or the neutron star slows down, the number of vortices must decrease. And the way they decrease is they migrate towards the wall of the bucket and annihilate there. So the idea is, as the Feynman vortices move towards the crust, because they are entangled with the other spaghettis, which are the magnetic vortices, they will drag the magnetic field. And that is how the magnetic field is deposited in the crust. So the idea is the flux is expelled from the core, not despite superconductivity, because Bardeen will not allow you to do that, but because of superconductivity. And the flux expelled to the crust can decay in ohmic dissipation, and this problem has been looked at very carefully by Dipankar, Sushant Kunar, and several others. And that is a more well-defined problem, and the physics is not intractable there. So I published this idea in a paper I was writing for Low Vulture, Volume 1, Number 1 of Astronomy Astrophysics Review, which was published in 1989. A few months later, Dipankar and I happened to be at Abdus Salam's institute in Trieste. There we teamed up with Muslimov and Sigan from the Yoffe Institute in St. Petersburg and developed that idea, and we published it in Current Science. This was the first issue of Current Science with a cover picture. And the physical content of this paper is summarized in this slide. Why the magnetic fields of solitary pulsars don't decay is very easily explained in this theory. This paper predicted that there'll be two populations of recycled pulsars. The first population, which consists of the first-born neutron stars from binaries with massive companions, such as the Hall-Steiner pulsar, will have a magnetic field of the order of 10 to the power 10 Gauss. There'll be a second population of recycled pulsars, the first-born neutron stars from low-mass binaries, the millisecond pulsars. Their magnetic fields will be of the order of 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss. And more interestingly, this paper gives a very simple and elegant explanation for why the magnetic field of recycled pulsars is an asymptotic field and why there is no further decay. Now, the predictions made in this Current Science paper were subsequently examined carefully and thoroughly by Jahan Miri, a very talented Iranian student who was working with me. Very sadly passed away a few months ago, and Deepankar Bhattacharya. Jahan, in his thesis, looked at this problem of coupling the vortices and dragging them out very carefully. It's a very difficult and subtle, physics is very, very subtle. He did the best he could. I think he did a pretty good job. And then Deepankar and Jahan revisited the current science paper and through detailed and quantitative calculations, confirmed the conjectures made in the current science paper. So what is the status of the predictions made in the 1990 current science paper? Well, here is the population of 2,500 pulsars again. That magenta line is the spin-up line corresponding to the Eddington accretion rate. Population 1 of recycled pulsars is inside the blue circle. These are binary pulsars with massive companion. Population 2 are the millisecond pulsars inside the red circle. And you see that their mean field is around 10 to the 10 Gauss, and the mean field is around 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss. Therefore, those predictions have been amply substantiated by subsequent observations. But the skeptics were not silenced. They continued to say, if millisecond pulsars are spun up and recycled, why don't we catch them being spun up? Why don't we see millisecond X-ray pulsars? Well, it took a long time, but in 1998, the Amsterdam group finally found millisecond X-ray pulsations from about a dozen low-mass X-ray binaries. But that didn't silence the critics. They said, but millisecond X-ray pulsations don't prove that there is a neutron star there and that is spinning with a period of milliseconds. Show me the neutron star. Well, the final nail in the coffin was driven on the 12th of June 2009 when a paper appeared in Science which showed that a low-mass X-ray binary suddenly switched off the X-rays and revealed a millisecond radio pulsar spinning at 1.7 milliseconds with a magnetic field of 3 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss. So it's a Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde story. In 2000, it was an X-ray binary. In 2009, it became a radio millisecond pulsar. And this Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde story seems to continue. It seems to be going back and forth. Such objects have now come to be known as transitional millisecond pulsars. I believe this is a very hot topic about which I don't know very much. I can't follow them because I don't have access to the journals. But here is a list of such transitional millisecond pulsars that switch from X-ray phase to radio phase. And then I'll finally come to yet another puzzle of the 1980s, which relates to recycled pulsars. And this concerns gamma ray emission from our galaxy that Prajwal referred to. The SAS-2 and COSB satellites had just produced the first map of gamma ray map of our galaxy. Admittedly, they were crude maps. What is interesting about this map is you see intense gamma ray emission, as you would expect, in the plane of the galaxy. But the top panel shows there is significant gamma ray emission above and below the plane of the galaxy as well. And that was a puzzle. Why was it a puzzle? Because the main source of gamma rays within our galaxy are the giant molecular clouds. Why? As cosmic rays pass through the molecular clouds, they produce bremsstrahlung. And that is how bulk of the gamma rays are produced in the galaxy. But the problem is that the molecular clouds are confined more or less to the plane of the galaxy. Their scale height is only about 60 parsecs. Therefore, molecular clouds cannot explain the high electric latitude gamma ray emission. What was the experts' view? This high latitude gamma ray emission is not real. They said it is instrumental in origin. Now, I didn't believe that it was instrumental in origin. Later data, in fact, showed that this high latitude emission was, in fact, real. Here is some very high signal to noise ratio, and you see this high latitude emission is extremely real. And yet there was no viable explanation for this. Now, besides the interstellar medium, the only other possible source of gamma rays were young pulsars like the Crab and Vela pulsar, which is 1,000 years and 10,000 years old, respectively. And indeed, they were very well-known sources of gamma rays. The problem with pulsars was that one expects the gamma rays only from very young pulsars. And very young pulsars will be found near their birthplace, namely the plane of the galaxy. It is true that pulsars get a kick when they are born and they migrate from the plane, but they also age as they migrate from the plane. So by the time they move a substantial distance from the plane of the galaxy, the voltage they generate is not enough to produce gamma ray emission. Therefore, neither the interstellar medium nor young pulsars like Crab and Vela could be invoked to explain the high latitude gamma ray emission from the galaxy. So in June 1988, I was invited to present a paper in the COSPAR General Assembly in Helsinki. And in that paper, I advanced the hypothesis that the high latitude gamma ray emission is due to a large population of millisecond pulsars. The title of my paper was Millisecond Pulsars, a New Population of Gamma Ray Sources. This was in June 1988. And what was the essential idea of this paper? Well, the intense gamma ray emission in the plane of the galaxy is well understood. What is being argued about is this diffuse gamma ray emission at high latitude. And my point was, this emission is not diffuse at all. It appears diffuse to you because you haven't wiped your spectacles. The angular resolution of your telescope is not adequate. Someday, God willing, when you have telescopes of high sensitivity and angular resolution, this diffuse gamma ray background will in fact be resolved into discrete point sources. And I conjecture that a significant fraction of these will in fact be millisecond pulsars. But please remember that in June 1988, only 3 millisecond pulsars were known. And yet this conjecture was made. Why did one expect this? First of all, the voltage generated by a millisecond pulsar is enough to produce a gamma ray. Secondly, because the magnetic field is weak, the gamma rays can escape the magnetic field, unlike in a strong magnetic field pulsar. But more importantly, there is a very large population of millisecond pulsars. At least we believed it, even though only 3 were known at the time. We believed that population could be as large as 100,000. Most importantly, we believed, a lot of current science paper of 1986, that millisecond pulsars live forever. They have drunk the youth elixir. They never age. They never age because the period derivative is almost zero. So in the entire history of the universe, a millisecond pulsar will lose only about 1 millisecond. Therefore, millisecond pulsars are young forever. And most importantly, they are expected to have a very large scale height corresponding to their progenitor. Victorially, the interstellar medium is a very thin slab. The young pulsars are slightly thicker slab, but the population of millisecond pulsars is a puffed up population and there is a very large scale height. What was the reaction? All the high priests of high energy astronomy were present in my talk. Ricardo Jacconi, Joachim Trumper, Binyami, Roger Blanford, Rashid Sunyaev, they were all there. They all poo-pooed this idea. First of all, they never believed there's a large population, and in other fora too. But Deepankar, in his characteristic fashion, pursued with this idea and tried to model the gamma ray emission from our galaxy using various electrodynamics models of pulsars that were available in the literature. And these investigations were published in papers September 1988, and in JAA 1991. 21 years after this prediction was made, came a series of headlines, culminating in an issue of Science of 14th August 2009 with a cover picture of the Fermi Large Area Telescope. And inside that issue, there was a paper entitled, "A Population of Gamma Ray Millisecond Pulsars Seen with the Fermi Large Area Telescope." There were 213 authors in this paper. At least 10 of them were present in my talk in Helsinki, but there was no reference to any of our papers. And what was said in the original paper? Millisecond pulsars, a new population of gamma ray sources. What was said was that diffuse gamma ray emission will someday be resolved into discrete point sources, and a large fraction of these discrete sources will in fact be millisecond pulsars. And here is the gamma ray map of the galaxy from the Fermi Large Area Telescope. The diffuse gamma ray background is gone. It is replaced by a set of discrete sources. a fraction of them are extragalactic sources like blazars, but the rest are millisecond pulsars. And today, roughly 100 millisecond pulsars have been found blazing away in gamma rays. And on that note, I shall end this tale of ignored and forgotten prediction. But please permit me a few moments to make some personal remarks after all we are gathered here today to remember Venu Bapu. That these original predictions have largely been forgotten by young researchers of today is perfectly understandable. These days, they don't care much about the history of the subject, who said the first word, who said the last word. And in any case, you and I know they don't read the paper. They have a database from which they pull out the references. What is more intriguing is why people who knew us personally chose to ignore us very systematically. And they were not budding young scientists who couldn't afford to be generous to other people. They were very well-established people. In fact, they were the high priests of the subject. Well, I shall leave it to social anthropologists to debate this issue. While all this is not very good for one's ego, what is positively insulting and humiliating is the attitude of our own colleagues in this country towards papers published in Indian journals. I served on the Council of the Indian Academy of Sciences for 18 years, and in meetings where young people were being assessed for major academic recognition, I often heard the following remark from high priests of Indian science. Well, if that paper is so great, why was it published here? Why not in Cell or Nature or Physical Review Letters? A close friend of mine appeared for a professorship in one of the IITs, and this interview committee asked him, how come you publish so many of your papers in Indian journals? There seems to be a theorem to which most people subscribe, and the theorem goes something like this. A necessary and sufficient condition for a paper to be good and great is that it should be published in Physical Review or Astrophysical Journal or what have you in some other subject. But what is forgotten is the following. 2 out of 3 papers gets accepted in Physical Review, and the rejection rate is not very different for Astrophysical Journal. As for citation, of the 360,000 papers published in Physical Review since the beginning, for more than 70% of them, the mean citation is 8.8 citations. And that number is not different for Astrophysical Journal. Compared to that, we haven't done too badly by publishing here. For example, the paper I wrote with Radhakrishnan in Current Science 35 years ago has been cited 286 times, despite the fact that for the first 20 years, Current Science was not covered by ADS. And 120 of those 286 citations have been during the last 10 years, and astonishingly 44 of them in the last 18 months. So that's not bad for publishing a paper in the local journal 35 years ago. Now let's move away from these anonymous citations by even more anonymous authors. Has never really turned me on. What has mattered to me more is the odd compliment from scientists I've greatly admired and secretly tried to emulate. Please permit me to cite a few such instances. 40 years ago, when I stumbled upon the idea of invoking the Eddington luminosity limit to derive the limiting period to which one can spin up a neutron star, I felt extremely happy. It was a very thrilling feeling for me to know that I thought of something that geniuses like Martin Rees, Sunyaev, Kip Thorne, and others who had published papers on the subject had overlooked. And therefore, their compliment meant a great deal to me. To them, it didn't matter that where the paper was published. Now, when I look back to 35 years ago, I'm astonished, absolutely astonished at my audacity to proclaim the solitary millisecond pulsar must have been recycled in a binary. This was the boldest, if not the most outrageous statement I've ever made in my life. Fortunately, it turned out to be correct. Now, in February 1985, I spoke about some of these ideas in a meeting of the Golden Jubilee meeting of the Indian Academy of Sciences. Chandrasekhar had come down for that meeting from Chicago, But he didn't attend that lecture by the fellows, and my talk was the very last talk that evening. So as the chairman announced my name, Chandrasekhar walked into the front door in faculty hall in IISc and sat down right in front of me in the first row. There was astonished silence in the room. Well, I didn't have a chance to talk to him after my talk because I had to rush to Chowdhury Hall to receive the great M.S. Subbulakshmi, who was giving a recital that evening in honor of Chandrasekhar. But next morning, when I did meet Chandra at RRI, the first thing he said to me was, it's marvelous that you were able to draw so many exciting conclusions based on such simple considerations. So I'll take that remark to my grave. As a piece of physics, the thing that gave me the greatest satisfaction was this crazy idea of coupling the vortices in the superconductor and superfluid to expel the magnetic flux. And when this paper was published in Current Science, I mailed copies of it to people all over the world. And pretty soon, there were several invitations to speak at prestigious meetings. Deepankar received several such invitations also. For those who invited us, it clearly didn't matter where the paper was published. But three of those meetings were very, very special to me, so please permit me to mention them. The first one was a very small meeting at Indian Institute of Science. It was an Indo-Russian meeting held to commemorate the 50th anniversary of Landau's famous paper on second order phase transitions. And what made that paper meeting memorable was 13 geniuses from the Landau Institute came to that meeting, including several of Landau's original students who had contributed mightily to superconductivity and superfluidity. It was tremendously challenging to stand in front of them and talk to them about superconductivity and superfluid, but it was also satisfying to pass their test. The second meeting was a very exclusive meeting on the occasion of the Dirac Medal being awarded to a very prestigious scientist. And what made that meeting special was it was being organized by Robert Schrieffer of the Bardeen Cooper Schrieffer theory fame. And when I got the invitation to speak, I was flabbergasted because the list of the other nine speakers read like who is who in physics. So when I went to the meeting, I asked Bob Schrieffer, Bob, why am I here? And he said, well, Srini, someone drew my attention to your paper. I got hold of a copy of it. I read it and decided you should be one of the 10 speakers. Well, the third meeting was an even more exclusive meeting with just 5 speakers in the Maxwell Theatre of the old Cavendish, and the occasion was the retirement of Sir Sam Edwards as the Cavendish Professor and Pro-Chancellor of Cambridge University. To top all this were the 2 postcards I received, one from the great Vitaly Ginsburg in Moscow and the other from A.B. Migdal in Princeton. They congratulated me for thinking of something that they had all overlooked. And the icing on the cake was the compliment I received from the master himself, P.W. Anderson. Having said all this, I must confess that I am very glad I'm not looking for a job today. Because in this day and age, where only citation indices, H indices, and impact factors of journals matter, no one would even look at my application, let alone offer me a job. Apart from the first paper I wrote in astronomy on the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, I voluntarily chose to publish all my papers in local journals. Are they automatically of lesser value because of that? I wonder what Venu Bapu would have said. After all, he started 2 journals, including the one of which a special issue is going to be released very shortly. I leave it to you to ponder about this, because many of you in this room sit in important committees where young people are being assessed. But I'm told that committees nowadays don't read papers. They just go by citation. And their defense, how else are we to value a paper? Well, my dear friends, when you are on such committees, it is your job to make a considered value judgment about the paper, subjective as it might be, rather than count citations. By the way, if you had just gone by citation, you would never have offered a job either to Einstein or to Richard Feynman. I shall end by recalling what Chandrasekhar said to me in the very last conversation I had with him in his life in the front lawn outside this building. We were talking about Indian journal. And he said, the only correct way to evaluate a scientist is to remove all his or her papers from the literature and ask, will it make a difference to the subject? I submit that all of us have to confront this question. I thank you most sincerely for your very kind indulgence. Thank you very much.